Propanacic, have you heard of this propanacic? Yes? Where it is used? Yeah? Yes, how it functions there? Have you heard of anion transporter, cation transporter, exchange transporters? Okay, well, here, there, what propanacic actually does is it is something like exchange transporter, okay, in the renal system. It conserves itself and excretes some other things. For example, if a propanacid is used here along with that, it can increase the excretion of this diuretic itself. Such things will happen. Okay. If it is used along with cotrimoxazole, they can be thrombocytopenia. The next group of drugs which we will be learning is about the thiazide group of diuretics. Okay. Thiazide group of diuretics. It inhibits sodium chloride transporter. Okay, we learned about the sodium chloride transporter here. Okay, what happened? What was the parathyroid hormone? All these things we have learned. Okay, so inhibit the sodium chloride transporter in the distal convoluted tubule. Here is the distal convoluted tubule. Increases the sodium and chloride excretion. Yes, sodium and chloride comes further. It's a also weak inhibitor of carbonic anhydrase and increase excretion of bicarbonate. Okay, so increase excretion of potassium, magnesium, and decrease excretion of calcium. Why there is decreased excretion of calcium? We learn it now. Okay, here is the human. We have the sodium chloride transporter system. Okay, this is the luminal side. Sorry, this is the basolateral side. Here is the human. Okay, yeah, change the position. That's it. Okay, once the sodium chloride system is acting, you have this. What is this channel? Chloride channel to take care of this chloride. Then we have sodium potassium intermediate system to take care of this sodium. What happens with thiazide diuretics is used? Okay, thiazide diuretics, it blocks the system and also it can block the parathyroid hormone mediated reactions. Okay, this is also affected, but this is affected in a different way. Okay, so you already got to know the system. Here we told that under the influence of this parathyroid hormone, we have a calcium channel in this side and a calcium sodium antiporter. Okay, calcium sodium antiporter on the basolateral side. Here, once the sodium which is coming inside here is decreased. But here we have a system which can exchange this calcium with the sodium. Are you getting my idea? The sodium which was entering from this system has decreased, but not the system which was entering the sodium, which was making the sodium more available due to the system. That means other than the system, there was a sodium provider here. And again, this can function better. But now, this channel, which was previously under this parathyroid hormone, is now also driven by the sodium deficiency which is created due to the block of this. So, more amount of calcium will enter as more amount of sodium is needed for this sodium potassium ATPase system. Are you getting? Is it clear? Okay. So, it becomes a calcium conserving diuretic. Okay. As the sodium which was entering was blocked, we have another system which can throw out the sodium for the cell, for the system to work. Okay, thereby we got the excess of calcium inside in exchange to the sodium. So that is the mechanism of the thiazide diuretics. Okay, so thiazide diuretics uses, we have hypertension as usual. Most of the diuretics we use it in hypertension. Congestive heart failure. Okay, what are the three B's of congestive heart failure? Yes, digitalis, diuretics, and vasodilators. Okay, digitalis, diuretics, vasodilators. You need to remember three B's. Okay, that means a thiazide diuretic can be helpful for us hypercalcemia. There will be some condition where the calcium reabsorption is not good and hypercalciuria are the needle stones. We can prevent this excess of calcium excretion and form decrease the formation of stones in this duct. How it is happening, we already explained. We can use in osteoporosis, sorry. Okay, here there is spelling mistake. Osteoporosis. Okay. Osteoporosis, that means we can go for this drug in case of a elderly female who has attained the menopause. Okay. Who is suffering with osteoarthritis, we can go for a diuretic which is calcium conserving. That will be our thyroid diuretics. So, nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. There are so many conditions, so many reasons why diabetes insipidus occurs. Okay, there will be neurogenic, there is neurogenic or psychogenic. Okay, then we have this nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. What is this diabetes insipidus? Any idea? Yes? ADHD. ADHD is? Inefficient? Decreased? Okay, so the neurogenic diabetes insipidus is due to excess of intake of water. The person thinks that he is thirsty and someone has told him that he has to drink a lot of water. He goes on drinking for more than 8 liters, 10 liters like that. That is neurogenic diabetes insipidus. Okay, here we can nephrogenic diabetes insipidus where the kidney functions are not appropriate to secrete back the amount of fluid which should be secreted back. Then in also for lithium toxicity we can go for this. In the previous time we saw that there can be lithium toxicity in that, but here we are using it in lithium toxicity. So thyroid adverse effects: hypokalemia, hyponatremia, hyperglycemia, diminished insulin secretion, elevated plasma lipids, hyperuricemia and hypercalcemia. I think we'll stop here.